Good evening, and sir, thanks a lot for this introduction. I thought I had sent a different bio because, at least in this crowd, in this gathering, it feels like home. So I don't have to say much about myself. Whatever turn of fate, I did become an entrepreneur fairly early in my life. I worked for Satyam Computers from 2000 to 2002 after BIT, and I must acknowledge this, that that whatever I am, absolutely whatever I am, is because of BIT Mesra. I have no friends from before BIT Mesra. I have only friends after from BIT Mesra, something very personal. I lost my father-in-law a couple of years ago, and I shared a very special relationship with him. And I discovered that I was into depression. I don't know how many people. So I ended up at a clinical psychologist for some time, and she would always ask me. I've never shared this in public ever before. She used to always ask me that, you know, share about your childhood. And my stories used to always start from BIT, never before. So BIT was a very special place. I truly enjoyed that. I've been asked to talk about getting over the startup blues. You guys are making me slightly go dry in my mouth, but let me. Thank you so much, sir. But let me share about this. So I started my journey in 2002. I co-founded a company called 6D Telecom Solutions, in which two of my batchmates later joined. They continued to run the company. I moved out of that company in early 2007 to start another company in late 2007. My first company was a software product company, and my second company is a mobile payments company. And now I have been an entrepreneur since 2002, so I have forgotten how many years that is. But let me share about Echo. You know, it is a company which, so it is a company which I started with a lot of hype. When I started 6D, my salary in Satyam was not even touching 10,000 rupees. And when I exited 6D, I exited with an 8-digit check, so which was a life-transforming experience for me. So it was on a very, very high, emotive high that I started Echo. But the journey very soon didn't remain at a very high. And just to share the perspective and just to share a glimpse of the pain I have gone through is that in 2007, a lot of companies started. Flipkart started, InMobi started. You would all know of Flipkart and InMobi and their success. You wouldn't know of Echo or Echo's failure so far. But I must talk about that there were some traps which probably were visible, but I and my team chose to ignore. So there's a lot of excitement when you started. You know, we started mobile payments. We built a technology which was fairly disruptive. We had all the acknowledgements. I mean, imagine that a company starts and in a little over a year, Bill Gates come and spends 2 hours in our office. What else can you ask for? So, you know, so we had all the great endorsements, but we really didn't, in all of that excitement of a new business, we chose not to see what was important to have to have been noticed very early on. We didn't realize that payments was a regulated space, and we must understand that ecosystem really well before we start scaling, you know. Some of you presented, one of the companies spoke about doing business with government. Stay away from government. Startups should stay away from government. When you become billion-dollar companies, go ahead and do business with the government, but not before you have $1 billion in your bank account. Till the time, figure out free trade zones, and I will explain what is free trade zone. You know, so we didn't realize regulations, we didn't realize that there were other participants in this ecosystem, you know, government, banks, mobile network operators, on which we were dependent. And we thought that we will be able to scale because we have this unique technology which we have built. It's unlike anything else across the globe. But that didn't really happen. Okay. And see, whom were we attracting? We were attracting Gates Foundation. We were not attracting Sequoia. And we were so blinded by it that we failed to see that these were not the right signals. These are absolutely the wrong signals. We should have, you know, these signals should have been picked by us, and we should have done some corrective measures. A lot of startups don't ever have less cash. It just kills you. A lot of people spoke about it. Ankit has gone through an experience. He shared his stories. Ashu shared his stories. Somil shared his stories. So it's very important that whatever money you had, you know, imagine I had so much of money. The amount of money I got when I exited 60, nobody in my family would have ever seen that kind of money. And that money we blew in less than 1 year of starting Echo. We had, you know, I mean, it was naivety and foolishness to the extent that we were getting from a B2B business, we were getting into a B2C business, we were getting into retail distribution and retail marketing, having absolutely zero experience. And we thought that, you know, this money is so much, it'll never get over. It got over in less than a year, just about maybe 6-8 months. So it's really important that don't ever have less money. I also spoke about, you know, in the hindsight, of course, I'm a lot smarter, but I think I should have been smarter then, and not to spoil the upbeat mood right now in the room, but really some things which some mistakes of mine which you should keep in mind is that, you know, you don't repeat them. We had a lot of dependencies, and these guys are not, they are very large players. So we are a very small player, and you're surrounded by very large players, very large banks, very large mobile network operators, regulator, government, they're all very, very large. You know, so we were excited, we signed up State Bank of India, we signed up Airtel, but we never stepped back to say that, are our interests aligned? Are our interests in this business aligned? And very soon we figured out that Airtel sees us as competition. You know, you don't want to be in race with Airtel. It is rather smarter to change your racetrack rather than get yourself on the same racetrack as Airtel. And what did we face? Complete abandonment. You know, in 2007, 8, 9, there was no newspaper which carried news about mobile payments and did not carry the name Echo. There was no conference in which I was not invited to speak. And now, in 2011, 12, here we were, and nobody was asking for us. Absolutely nobody was asking for us. It was very, very, very shattering experience to be left completely isolated. And I'm saying this that, you know, you don't want to, it's very difficult to fail fast in India. And if you need to survive, then you got to make sure that you don't go through a really, really deep fall, deep low. It is very energy sucking, and it's a very negative spiral. And we were into a negative spiral starting 2012, absolutely going down the hill. What does this do? You know, people leave. I lost a lot of good colleagues, smart people around me, I lost them. You know, there was lack of scale. Lack of scale leads to laziness, lack of discipline, and all of that. I mean, imagine if you walk into my office at 10:30 and you don't find anybody. Imagine that after 6:30 there is nobody in the office. So you can imagine such a working place, right? You guys, I'm sure, are working 24/7, irrespective of Sundays, Saturdays, holidays, whatever. And we had to go through a phase where it was extremely, extremely painful. But we didn't shut down. We kept pushing hard. We literally had to fight very hard to remain in the race. And there are a few things which we learned. Never use your money for sustenance. Always use your money for scale. If you are in a mode of sustenance, use your money. But if you have taken investors' money, don't use it if you are not able to scale. Cut down team, get into your freeze mode, but don't use money for sustenance, because every month the salary needs to be paid out. And you don't realize you keep paying, and your cash keeps coming down. So all of this, you know, all of this, these signals, make sure that you have it at the back of your mind. If you observe this, some of these symptoms in your business, then become really very alert. Is all what I want to share with you guys today. So while we did understand that we have put ourselves in an ecosystem which is not going to let us scale, and we had to change our ecosystem. You know, we worked really hard, but we kept using the money for sustenance. So we finally managed to get a prepaid license from RBI. While we have got that license, we have very little money left now to scale it. Okay, so it makes the problem even more complex. It's not that it can't be solved, it just makes it more complex. You don't want to push yourself to such a situation. It's never helpful. You know, it is better if you apply your mind for scaling rather than solving a complex problem statement of survival. But we did do a few things right. There are two sets of people in the company. There are guys who are always arbitraging their resume, and there are believers. Get rid of people who are arbitraging their resume. They are the dangerous kinds. They are the ones who will not stick around with you. They are the opportunistic ones. So the believers are the ones who have really helped turn around Echo, and not the ones who are looking for a resume arbitrage. So be very careful when you are looking for colleagues and team members. And now we are at a stage that, you know, we got to bust the myth around us, you know. And it is so. One more systemic challenge which startups face is that, as founders, when we are trying to solve a problem, we are really thinking like a product guy. And we're saying that, okay, such a problem exists. All of you who presented today, all of you, have the capability to identify a certain problem statement and propose a solution. That is very, very different from scaling the business. So thinking innovatively and scaling the business are two very different things. Scaling the business is all about chopping wood efficiently. Their innovation has very little role to play. But product has a lot of innovation. So it's very important, that when you are running your business and you have created your prototype, and you now believe that the time is right for that prototype to get scaled, make sure that you're hiring people who can help you scale. Make sure that you're getting skill sets of people who have the experience of chopping wood efficiently. It's really the efficiency which you got to drive when you're scaling. And scaling is all what matters at the end of the day. All ideas have been very good, Facebook great, but if Facebook wouldn't have scaled, then Facebook wouldn't be Facebook. So there was one gentleman who said that ideas are worth nothing, don't be afraid of somebody copying your idea. And I completely endorse that statement. We have literally done so much of work and opened up so much of our work in open source, in various other communities. Nobody has been able to replicate what we have developed as far as core IP is concerned. Where we have failed so far has been our ability to scale. But timing is now getting really right for payments, and payments is getting unbundled in the country in many ways. There are a lot of infrastructure pieces which are coming around. So it's also the time for all of us in Echo to reimagine the world again. We reimagined it for microtransactions happening on feature phones in a certain way back in 2007. But today it's a different world. It's a world where you have infrastructure pieces like NPCI, like UID, you have such huge penetration of smartphones. And we're going to see disruptions in data. One data being generated on smartphones. The other is that the government is now putting a lot of data which can get consumed. I don't know how many of you noticed, but the Department of IT came out with an API policy. With the roadmap of opening up a lot of government data sources. So it is really important that, and then we'll have data from devices. So it's really important for all of us in Echo, and this is to some of you who are trying to build new businesses, is to also look at some of these trends which are happening in our country. By the way, this is very unique. What happens is that, and again, this was discussed earlier today, that investors join dots to what happens in US or China. So if in US, middle-class customers go online and check whenever they have to buy a new car, and we see a very similar behavior replicate itself in China, then that makes basis for, say, a company like CarDekho to raise money, because the hypothesis is that middle class people in America, in the US, and in China are behaving similarly. So in India also, they will behave in a very similar manner. So it is very, but these infrastructure pieces are fairly unique to our country. This is not there globally. So it creates a huge opportunity for us to create very specific models for solving certain problem statements, which are absolutely of India. and not a replication of a model from US or China. So notice that some of these things are happening. I would have loved to see somewhere if people would have spoken about UID and how UID is being used in their app for authentication, for KYC, for deduplication. I would have loved to see more social media integration in the apps, because that's a huge trend. What people are doing with, so people spoke about analytics, but let's not leave it at just analytics. I have the liberty of leaving it at data. But when you're making your pitch, you got to be a little bit more detailed around how are you going to be using data? Because data is going to become really, really important. We are, today if you look at the economy, we are in an economy which runs by discounts. But there are already trends that will enter into an economy which will run by surveillance. I don't know how many of you have noticed a company called Mubble. It's a Bangalore-based company. And what Mubble does is that it captures your calling data, your data consumption on the mobile, and tells you how effectively have you used your data pack which you have taken from your MNO, and recommends you the right data pack to be bought. So there are trends which will help us move from a discount economy to a surveillance economy. And so just be vigilant to some of these changes which is happening in your ecosystem. Make sure that these are fundamental to what you guys are doing. Some of the ideas here were really excellent, really unique in many ways. But that unique quotient can be increased when you leverage India-specific infrastructure and India-specific trends which are happening. There's another company called Gigato. I don't know how many of you have heard of Gigato. And many more who are now, because a lot of us, when we download an app and when we select the permissions, we just go ahead and openly give away our data such that different offers could be extended to us. So it's important that when we think of business models, they should be hard to replicate. If it is easy to replicate, then you will see that the investors will say that you are more of the same. How are you different? Make sure that you don't get into that trap. And if you look at the ecosystem, you can create things differently. Echo is trying to do a few things differently. So we are also at a point in time where we are trying to pivot ourselves. And we are saying that there is no credit card in the country which is of lesser than 20,000 rupee denomination. And we're saying that there's a huge market wherein you can have credit cards from, say, up to 20,000 rupees. So most of us will get a credit card with, say, 100,000 rupees of credit for 50 days. But imagine if you could extend credit of just 3,000 rupees for a week. And imagine if this credit card was only and only available on your phone and not as a plastic. Some of those things are going to be very disruptive in nature. And that is what Echo is now trying to transform itself into. So payments is the hook for us to get on our next set of customers and merchants. But the way we wish to drive this business is to use the flows data between the consumer and the merchant, feed that into these new kinds of NBFCs who are underwriting using data. And in partnership with them, create products which are miniaturized credit card kind of products, but without the card. So that's what Echo is doing today. Just to conclude this, we do about 200 crore rupees of transactions a month. We cater to about 5 million customers. and we are now really, breaking from the wrong tags which we have got attached to, breaking the myth around us and positioning ourselves as a more mainstream payments provider. But it's a very tough journey. I would have loved not to have put ourselves into such a spot. So that's my parting statement. All of you are a lot smarter than I am. And you have much smarter ideas, product ideas, which are truly exciting. Make sure that you have, learned from my mistakes. Thank you so much.